Larkspur Council Member Catherine Way.
And the Larkspur Planning Commission.
Excellent, wonderful.
Welcome, everybody.
That's great.
Okay, and we have some, we have a great panel tonight, but I also, Camilla Fox is here. She's the founder and executive director of Project Coyote. Camilla, are you? Welcome. I want to introduce our panelists. We have Kelly Hendricks is here. She's also with Project Coyote. We have Captain Cindy Machado, the Director of Animal Services in the Marin Humane Society. And we have David Herlocker with Marin County Parks and Open Space. And so we're looking forward to a great event. We're actually going to record this, and so we'll link it to the Corte Madera and Larkspur sites, as well as the Central Marin Police Authority site. So if anyone has any questions in the community after this, you can always come back and relive this night or share that with your fellow community members. And with that, I will turn it over to you. Thank you.
Well, welcome, everybody. I don't know if you're going to be able to see this screen from your seat, so feel free to adjust your chair. We're going to turn the lights down. We have some videos. Our goal is to give you a lot of information tonight, but also leave time for your questions. So at the end of our session, we'll be happy to answer your questions. So just a few rolls. This is a good time, if you haven't already, to silence your phone and put your phone away. If you have to step out, please do so discreetly, not to disturb your neighbors. And we want to also, as part of our rules, thank the town of Larkspur and Corte Madera and all of the politicians that are here in support of this, because it's a really important topic that goes all through Marin, not just down here. We are blessed with two amazing experts in this field. I'm at the Humane Society, but to my right is David Herlocker, who is an amazing naturalist with the Marin County Parks Department. David is so knowledgeable on everything in our environment, animal species. He does a lot of programs at our local Humane Society. He has his own fan club of animal talk groupies that appear, so we really appreciate David using his expertise tonight. On my left is Kelly Hendricks. She's one of our favorite ranching members affiliated with Project Coyote. Kelly's role with Coyote Management is more on the ranching side, which is important for you to know because that's really how coyotes came back in Marin after our ranching community kind of altered how we do predator control. And my story is pretty simple. I've just been at the Humane Society for the last 32 years. I started when I was 12, and I love every day I'm there. And so I'm just blessed to be able to continue to be there and share the information that I've had over the years. What we're going to attempt to do tonight is give you an overview of the natural history of coyotes, kind of specifically to the Marin coyotes that we have had the privilege and honor to learn all about over the few decades we've been monitoring coyotes. We're going to talk about successful coexistence strategies, and that's going to be the takeaway message tonight, is coexistence. You'll learn that these coyotes are here to stay. They're expanding throughout Northern California, so it's our job to learn as much as we can on how we coexist properly. I'm going to do a special session on hazing techniques and keeping our pets safe, because those are the calls we routinely get a lot of concern about. And lastly, we're going to talk about, you know, the Marin Coyote Coalition and how that came to be. It started to our neighbors down in Mill Valley, but it's quite an amazing story. So with that, I'm going to turn the reins over to David. And remember,
which
that
is the button?
Right there.
In there. And can you hear me? All right, well, first of all, I want to thank you all for coming. This is an engaged community. It's just, you know, hats off to you. Not everybody would come to a presentation like this, so thanks for coming. Before I roll into it, I have the easy job. I get to just sort of talk about the life histories of the biology of coyotes and just give you a sense of why they're doing what they're doing, when they're doing it, just to put a little perspective on what these animals are doing. But I also want to say that before I got this job, I was a zookeeper, and for 8 of those years, I was a coyote keeper. And I have to tell you that of all the animals I worked with, and we actually have to train some animals, coyotes were just about the smartest of all. And that's the really good news, because what we're going to talk about tonight is using their intelligence to train them to do what we want them to do. And to train, we have to use our intelligence. humans are relatively intelligent as well. We have to use our intelligence to play this game properly. So just so you know, coexistence isn't a compromise. It is a really proven, it is the method for getting along. If I thought that removal of animals by any means was the best way to keep a community safe, I'd advocate for it. But what we're going to talk about tonight is what's been proven, what works, and you know, our hearts are really into this. So all of that, and I'm just going to give you the basic life history of coyotes. First, I also want to say I don't take photographs. I just steal them off the web. So just so you know, I have to say that every time. So we'll just do it through the season. So right now in the winter, the coyotes in Marin are blessed with this great climate that we have, so they don't have to follow a really rigid cycle. But for the most part, this is pretty much when the pairs are rebonded, if you will. New pairs have been formed, and the mating season will probably start, usually starts around January, into February. So a coyote has about a two-month gestation cycle. The usual size of a coyote litter is 3 to 7, 5 pups is average, but urban coyote populations have been shown to have larger litters, and that's probably due to population control by automobile. Okay, they have a lot of coyotes don't make it because they get hit by cars. So that's a natural control, and the response to removal of animals is that they ramp up their breeding a little bit. So one thing that I'll talk to a little bit as we go along is that when coyotes are born, they're born in a den, and that there isn't just one den. Coyotes move their little guys around for a couple of months. The mother will move the pups around and use multiple dens, and that's something that will make a difference. So again, in winter, they're breeding. In spring, the coyotes emerge. In the summer, basically, the pups actually start to venture around. The coyotes don't have a lot of natural predators, especially here in Marin County, but they're very, very secretive about their pups when they're still small enough to fall prey to larger animals. Then in the fall, you get some pups disperse, not all. Some of them stay in family groups. And that brings up another thing. You can never say always about coyotes. Coyotes are one of the most adaptable the animals there are. So their behavior is extremely plastic. A coyote that lives in Tiburon has a completely different life than a coyote that lives in, in Point Reyes. Well, there's plenty. Anyway, so pair formation takes place in the fall, and that's when I start getting calls. I'm the person who gets the calls with Marin County Parks. In fact, I get the calls no matter where the coyotes are, because somehow my phone number shows up. I start getting calls about 20 to 30 coyotes are right behind my house right now, and do something about it. That usually starts to happen right September, October. And what's really interesting is that's basically, coyotes are the tricksters, right? The Native Americans view them as the tricksters. And so I think I mentioned that I was a zookeeper once. I used to close my exhibit and wait a few minutes and then start giving a little spiel on coyotes. And I could give a cue. I had two at a time. I always had two. I could give a little cue and get them to vocalize. And coyotes could yip, yap, and howl at the same time. And I'd ask the audience to tell me how many coyotes were in there. The guesses ranged from, 2 to 30, but the average was about 12. And coyotes are basically doing that on purpose. They're basically sounding like, my pack is bigger than your pack is sort of what they're saying. And they're communicating among themselves in many cases, but they're also communicating with the coyotes across the canyon because those high-pitched sounds carry a long way. But the vocalizations are all about basically talking about territory. Vocalizations can also help sort of stimulate the breeding cycle for the animals too. I cannot work from notes.
Do you want me to click on the vocalizations? Do you want to play the vocalizations?
Oh, of course I want to play the vocalizations.
That's the best part.
I forgot that speaker meant something. All right, so the first thing is, we've all heard that one. So it's a show. We'll talk about this, but I just want to get to the next one here. So that's four animals, and I only think three of them are talking during that last little part right there. It sounds like an awful lot, right? And that last little part was actually, so coyotes, even if they live in a family unit, they wander around on their own. And so when you see a lone coyote, it doesn't mean it's a transient. It's usually part of a family group, but they don't necessarily hang around with one another all the time. And a lot of the vocalizations that we hear are basically they're greeting one another. So when they come back together, when the family unit comes back together, they just sort of chat it up really big like that. So you hear that particular type of vocalization. Around here, we hear it a lot in the evening. And we'll say that coyotes are pretty naturally, well, they're plastic in their behavior. Coyotes tend to be diurnal, but the coyotes that live in the urban area in the fringe have learned that we're diurnal, so they have adapted to a more of a nocturnal lifestyle. What's important about that is seeing a coyote in the daytime, does not mean, you know, we were all raised to think that if you see a nighttime animal in the daytime, it means it's sick. That's a natural thing for them to do. So pairs get established. If there is a territory that can support a young single male and a young single female, they will bond and they will establish their territory. They usually establish their territory based on the carrying capacity of the area, whether or not they can get enough food to eat and to raise pups. And the territory and the home range are usually delineated by scent marking. A lot of times when you're walking on the trail, you know, domestic dogs don't tend to go right in the middle of the trail, but there's a reason that coyote scat is in the middle of the fire road or right where roads cross. And a lot of times you'll see several different scats, including bobcat scats mixed in with coyote scats, where an animal trail crosses a fire road. So that's, you know, that's the confluence of some territories. So that's, you know, we're sort of olfactorily retarded, but there's so much information in those scats that those animals can know what the neighbor's doing, they can know how old their daughter is, they could find out all kinds of stuff about one another just from smelling those scats. There we go. All right, so coyotes, although coyotes are classified as carnivores, they're omnivorous, and they eat an awful lot of plant material. So the numbers you see up there were for actually suburban. Urban's a little different. That the coyote scat, and this is from hundreds and hundreds of animals, was 42% rodents. And I want to put a note on that. One of the reasons that coyotes come into towns is because one of the things that we bring with us are rodents. You know, even in the richest communities in the world, there are lots of house mice and rats. And coyotes' primary diet in virtually all situations are rodents. And so there's a lot of things that we can do to reduce rodent populations that aren't poison, and that can also dissuade coyotes from being near our homes. But you see fruit, and then you see deer with that big asterisk there. Coyotes eat a lot of carrion, okay? A lot of roadkill. And deer, as we all know, end up on the side of the road a lot of the time. And that's fresh meat to be had. So coyotes do feed on deer, but more often they are deer that have already been injured or killed by automobiles or by other means. But you should also think about all the other carrion that we see, and coyotes drag it off. And the picture at the bottom there is one that I just wanted to point out, that coyotes do become habituated to people. And I want everybody in this room to, for the rest of your lives, that apple core, it's organic, isn't it? But if you toss that apple core out, I don't know, on the side of the trail or wherever you're eating, you're basically teaching coyotes that places where people eat food are good places to come hang out. So dogs love apples. Some of us know that. Anyway, so apple cores, you know, don't do things to encourage coyotes to come closer. Even a little thing like that is an important thing. So body language. Coyotes are really scary animals, and that's one of the things that they do. Their body language, generally speaking, that catches our attention is the body language that they do that says, you know, get back. Almost everybody that I talk to when they describe a coyote will describe it as German Shepherd size, even people who have German Shepherds. The coyotes that live here are about 30, 35 pound animals. Okay, a German Shepherd usually is 70, 80 pounds, you know, even bigger than that. They have long hair. They have really long legs. So they do not look like a 35 pound dog. It's a border collie size in terms of just the mass of its body. But they do an awful lot of things that make themselves look big and bad. They can raise their hackles. They can arch their back. And body language is extremely important. And when we start talking about hazing, what we're going to talk about is our body language, how we can speak their language and say, nah, this is my block. So remember that. That's a very important factor. Coyotes, we're going to talk a lot about interactions with dogs. I can just jump to here. One of the main most important things about coyotes and understanding coyotes is recognizing denning behavior, recognizing that when coyotes are letting you know that you're near a den. I just wanted to show you a couple of examples here. The picture at the top left is, that's actually really common. If you go out to Point Reyes, an awful lot of burrows that were maybe made by a gopher, and then a badger dug that gopher up, and maybe a fox made it a little bigger, and then coyotes can live in there. Coyotes can have really spacious tunnels underground. But in a lot of other situations, do I have a laser on this thing?
Yes.
Oh, it doesn't matter. That little rock outcrop with the pups in there is more of a natural situation. But slabs and porches in human establishments are very, very, very common denning places. So that's another thing that we're doing that attract these animals. So you kind of have to keep track of what your attractants are, and you can create a den site quite easily. So when coyotes have a den, or I should say dens. I think I mentioned already that coyotes have multiple dens. For the first few months of their pup's life, they'll move them around. They will do the big bad act. Usually it's in response to dogs being nearby. I'll talk about that. But it could be just because you're walking by. And it really is, that's a terrifying looking animal, and it's growling, and it is really telling you that you should not be there. So if you see an animal acting like that, you are probably too close to its den. There's really no other reason that a coyote acts like that. They don't defend their kill. It's basically you're really close to their den. And if you have a dog, they might actually walk toward you because your dog is a real threat to them and their den. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. So why do they feel threatened by your dog? Well, you look at the top left, that's a wolf, and on the top right, that's a coyote, and those two animals in the middle are also wolves. So all domesticated dogs were derived from wolves. So the two that are more closely related there are the wolf and the dogs. That chihuahua is a wolf, okay? But the old concept of species that I learned back in the dark ages when I went to school was, species cannot interbreed with one another. But these are all really one species. The coyote and the wolf can breed with one another. There are coy wolf populations in North America. And coyotes and dogs breed. Anyway, I guess the other thing I want to say is they don't just feel threatened. There are coy dogs are also a lot more common than we thought. In fact, I have some numbers. I don't remember numbers very well. So I came across this. This is a study in rural Illinois. 15% of 10,000 coyotes taken annually in Illinois for their fur during the early 1980s may have been coy dogs based on cranial measurements. So there's a lot more interbreeding between those going on. But the population in that area at that time was estimated to be between 20,000 and 30,000 coyotes. So that just made me stop. They're removing half of the population of coyotes every year, right? And there's going to be 20,000 again next year. So I just want to touch on that, this idea that if you have coyotes and you want to get rid of them, you get your guns and shoot them. It's exactly the wrong thing to do. Anyway, but the coyotes will often feel that dogs might be more threatening, especially if they're not fixed, or they might be more attracted to a dog that is not neutered. But most of our dogs are neutered. I just threw in a little information on the coy wolf. But we don't have those here, and I want to let my co-speakers have some time. How long have I been talking? Oh, well. And this is kind of a cute video. We can show a little bit of it. I was...
The same methods that destroyed wolf populations haven't even dented coyote numbers. But why? When large numbers of coyotes are killed, there's more food for those that are left. So females produce more milk
and healthier pups with a better chance of survival. Initially blind and helpless, the pups will open their eyes in 10 days. The mother nurses them inside the den for 4 weeks, fed by the male and younger pack members.
Swains and thrush.
Eventually, they emerge into the outside world, wide-eyed, but with their ears still furled. Even at this highly tender age, they demonstrate the typical coyote enthusiasm for singing.
Okay, so I basically just wanted you to see the fact that that they literally walk out of the den and sing for the rest of their lives. Their scientific name means talking dog. They are the songsters of the animal world. I think I've already hit on all of that. So on the average, about half of the pups survive their first year. You can see this picture on the left. I believe that's in San Francisco. So again, in urban situations, litters can get very large, but most of them do not make it to adulthood. So in late summer and fall, this is when the pups, they're still smaller than mom and dad, but they're learning by observation. These are really intelligent animals that don't just have hard wiring to know what to eat and where to eat it. They basically have to follow mom and dad and learn what to eat. And things like rodent populations and stuff, those can be variable. You just have to recognize habitat. But one of the important things is fruit sources basically are stationary. So they have to learn where those things are in the area because they're all going to go spread out and help feed one another eventually. And then they start spending more time away from their parents. During the first winter, the pups basically are pretty much full grown. Some of them stay with their parents. Again, this is a really variable thing. Sometimes you'll have packs and sometimes you'll have just one pair and they'll always exclude their young. It's very, very hard to predict what's going to happen. So the ones that do live independently basically are transient or travelers. So those are the ones that we can see wandering around. If they can't find a territory, they basically have to keep on walking, and a lot of them end up not making it either. But at the bottom there, it says resource limitations and personality conflicts will sometimes cause animals to also be excluded from the pack. But the pack is basically just a very cohesive family unit. Usually it's mom, dad, and it might be the siblings from more than one litter. We'll touch on this a few more times. Only the alpha male and female breed, so the other pups basically wait their turn or have to leave in order to become breeders and have pups of their own. So they are very territorial about other coyotes in particular, so they keep transients from entering and using their territory. Coyotes are monogamous. I have to put an asterisk on that. I think there's a little more study showing that there's a slighter tendency for pairs to break up than we once believed. Camilla can address that perhaps. Anyway, and as you saw in the BBC thing, the siblings and the father actually help to raise the litters. The mother stays with the pups in the den, and dad comes home and regurgitates food to the group for at least a month or so. And that's why having your older brothers and sisters around to help is also very important. I got to the end. Anyway, I'll be here for questions later. I know I left a lot out.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. My name's Kelly Hendricks, and I'm the Ranching with Wildlife Coordinator for Project Coyote. My husband and I live and work on a cattle ranch in Sonoma County, where he's ran the cow-calf operation for over 20 years. And I also volunteer with Sonoma County Wildlife Rescue, and I foster wildlife and work in the hospital. And like, I work with coyotes, and like David says, they're super smart, and also they're something that surprises some people is they're pretty big chickens. Of all the animals I work with, they're one of the least aggressive. They don't want to hassle with anybody. They don't want to fight with dogs. They don't want to fight. They're just kind of big chickens. So now Western gray squirrels, on the other hand, are really, can be really aggressive. So that always surprises people about them. But I'm also a retired horse trainer. And so I've worked on ranches most of my life. And I saw, I've seen all the lethal controls used to control predators on behalf of livestock, to protect livestock, and I've seen it as completely ineffective. So I always knew that when I retired from horse training that I wanted to, I just always thought if we spent half as much effort and time and money trying to learn to live with these animals as we did killing them, that, you know, we could save a lot of wildlife and a lot of livestock. So when I stopped horse training, I got a hold of Camilla and told her that, you know, reached out to her in Project Coyote and said I wanted to help. And you got to be careful what you wish for, because she's kept me very busy. So let's see if I'm going the right way. Oh, so what is Project Coyote? In a nutshell, we're an organization that advocates for predators in North America. And Camilla chose the coyote because, unlike foxes and wolves, which can be found on other continents, coyotes are exclusively found in North America. And also because, as the most persecuted, one of the most persecuted animals in America, she felt that if we could teach people how to appreciate and understand coyotes better, then we could get people to appreciate all wildlife a little bit better. So we're a coalition of scientists, educators, predator-friendly ranchers, and citizen leaders, and we're working to teach people the truth about predators and to learn how to live with them. So some of our programs are coyote-friendly communities. That's where we give resources and educational materials to communities so they can teach people how to coexist with predators. We work with state wildlife agencies reforming predator policies and trying to modernize them. Most historically, wildlife in America is managed on behalf of consumptive users, like hunters and ranchers. And the majority of the public, which doesn't hunt or ranch, has very little say in how these animals are managed. So, and the majority of the way they're managed doesn't reflect the modern understanding of their important role in our ecosystems. They're thought of, in a lot of times in most states, as pests to exterminate. So we're trying to modernize a lot of the policies across the nation. Ranching with Wildlife is a program where we reach out to ranchers to try to help them with tools to coexist with predators rather than killing them, to protect their wildlife. Keeping It Wild is our youth program, and this is kind of really cool because we teach kids how to protect wildlife and to advocate for them and educate them about them, and then they teach other kids. But the cool thing is, like, these kids will get whole classrooms come and testify at Fish and Game Commission meetings on behalf of wildlife. And it's the voice of the kids has really been one of the main reasons we've got some really strong protections in place in the last few years for wildlife, like the ban on bobcat trapping in California now. The gray wolf was added to the endangered species list, and we had the loopholes closed, which allowed for wildlife killing contests to take place in California. And those successes were in large part due to the voices of the kids that came and spoke about it. So in science, our science advisory board has some of the top wild canids scientists in the world. And there's Dr. Bob Crabtree on the left, if I can figure out how to use this laser. Giving a coyote presentation. Those are some of the kids from the Keep It Wild, part of our Keep It Wild program, advocating for wolves. And then these kids right here are from Fairfax Manor Elementary, and they came and spoke to the California Fish and Game Commission. They did an amazing job. Cutest kids. So as part of our Ranching with Wildlife program this year, we had a workshop where we had 11 experts from different fields like vineyard managers, predator-friendly ranchers, scientists, come and speak with ranchers about how to protect their wildlife, new tools they can use, best management practices on tools they've been using. And that's me installing a fox light. It's a predator deterrent device on a ranch in Marin County. And we do public outreach to teach people about predators. And that's Camilla over there giving a presentation on wolves. So one thing we got here in Marin, which is pretty cool, is the Marin Livestock and Wildlife Protection Program. And it's the first of its kind in the nation, and it's a cost-share program that took the money that they used to spend killing predators, and they take that money and they put it towards helping ranchers and assisting them with non-lethal protections. So it's a really neat deal. And how this came about, how many people here have heard of the Department of Wildlife Services? Okay, this is a good indication of one of the main problems. So it's a really, it manages to operate under the radar of most people, and it's taxpayer-funded federal agency that kills millions of wild animals in the United States every year, and a lot of them are done on behalf of private businesses like ranchers and hunters. So they trap, they gas pups in the den, they aerial gun, and somehow they manage to stay under the radar. But in the late 1990s, they wanted to put these collars on sheep in Marin. And these collars are called livestock protection collars. And what happens is when the coyote attacks the sheep, that bladder on that collar is filled with a poison called compound 1080. And that bladderal rupture kills the coyote and it kills the sheep. And of course, poison gets into the ecosystem. So understandably, the public in Marin said, we don't want these collars being used. And went to Wildlife Services, says, we don't want to use those collars. And they said, well, we demand to have every use of every tool in our toolbox. So in 2000, the county here ended the contract with Wildlife Services, and they approved the non-lethal program that started that cost share program. So I'm not going to go into that. It's too depressing. Okay. So why killing doesn't work, and David touched on this, and it's super important. There's a saying in the ranching community that if you kill one coyote, two will show up for its funeral. And that is based on this premise of how coyotes react to lethal controls. So like David said, you got the coyote pack here on the left. That's a stable coyote pack. You got the mom and the dad, the pups of this year, and then their older siblings. Now, in a stable pack like this, only the mom and the dad are going to breed, and all the rest are behaviorally sterile. They will not breed while they're part of that pack. Now, when this pack's disrupted with lethal controls, what happens is those younger ones can all start breeding, and they breed at younger ages, and they have larger litters, and more pups survive. Not only that, they don't have the life experience. They haven't learned everything from their parents about how to provide for their pups, so they're more likely to come in contact and seek out vulnerable play like pets and livestock. So it's a double whammy of unintended consequences. So it's just a really important concept. And you might have, after you kill off a bunch of coyotes, you might have a temporary lull where you think, oh, this kind of worked. But then what happens is it goes horribly wrong after that. So it's really important concept to understand about coyotes so that you know why if someone loses a pet or people are afraid of coyotes, then they think, well, we'll just kill them. It doesn't work. Not only that, but studies have shown that in order to get rid of coyotes, let's say you wanted to get rid of them, you'd have to kill 75% of the population for like over 50 years to actually eliminate them. Yes?
You haven't talked about, what about relocation? Is there any
situation? It's illegal in California to relocate wildlife. And even if you could, I think 75% of the relocated wildlife will die within the first 3 months because they don't know where resources are and for territorial disputes and disease and things like that. And you can spread disease to new areas.
But it would be the same as killing them in terms of what she's talking about. If you remove an animal, if you put it somewhere else, you still generate the increased production of coyotes. So they tried it.
Yeah, so there's a lot of unintended consequences with relocation, too. It sounds good. Oh, we'll just relocate him and everybody's happy, but it's actually worse for wildlife, and it's worse for people. So some of the non-lethal tools that ranchers can use are livestock guardian animals, llamas, burros, and dogs. Night pens are just predator-proof pens, smaller ones, that you can put the animals in at night when predators are more active in hunting. Fencing, electric fencing is great. Fox lights, that's the product I was installing. You can see one right there. That was invented by an Australian sheep rancher who was losing sheep lambs to foxes. So he'd go out in the middle of the night and patrol his fields with a flashlight, and you know he wouldn't be losing his animals anymore. So he thought, he got tired of doing that. He invented this, and it won Australia's Shark Tank sort of show. And so it's just random LED lights that flash throughout the night, and it emulates the look of somebody patrolling the field with a flashlight. And they're being used all over the world in a lot of different applications to protect wildlife. So, this is a video. How do I play the video?
I'm going to do it for you.
This just shows how llamas can protect livestock. It's kind of interesting if you've never seen it before.
So is there any way to manage coyotes? Some people, like sheep farmer Maggie Jolson, believe they found a natural technique.
The old-fashioned way of controlling coyotes is with a gun. But I believe a lot of ranchers and stewards of the land are changing at this point.
And they're doing it by putting guard animals such as burros or donkeys, dogs and llamas in their flocks.
All the different guard animals do different things. The burros, the male burro has a tendency to chase away the coyotes. The female burro pretty much stays within the herd. Then my llama, the llamas just don't like dog-like animals.
An unguarded flock of sheep is defenseless. But aggressive guard animals can protect it. The coyote is harassed until it is confused and eventually looks elsewhere for a more predictable meal.
With all of them up here, I feel fairly safe. And for me, it's the most logical thing to do is to have the guard animals. It's much more efficient than government trapping or anything, because they're always here and they do what they do naturally.
And that's an interesting point she kind of goes over here, is that people have a tendency to they don't hold lethal controls up to the same standards that they hold non-lethal tools. In other words, sometimes people, just your knee-jerk reaction if you feel threatened by coyotes is you want them killed. Well, in short order, people are going to lose more pets or livestock or whatever the deal, because more coyotes come in. We've talked about that disruption, what it causes. But people never say, oh, shoot, that killing doesn't work. But if you give them a fox light or something, it's in the field, and then in another year, if they lose an animal, they're like, ah, it's a piece of crap. So it's an interesting psychology that non-lethal tools are held to such a high standard where lethal aren't. But so the benefits of the Marin Livestock and Wildlife Protection Program is proactive. Non-lethal tools are proactive. They can prevent problems before they occur, whereas lethal tools are reactive, and you're basically waiting until after livestock or whatever is killed and then addressing it. It saves the county money, it stabilizes coyote communities, and allows them to do their job, which is eat rodents. And a single coyote can eat 1,800 rodents in a year. So that makes a pack a huge free source of pest control. So predation of livestock is down, it's more humane, and it's a model for other communities that can be scaled up or changed to fit different communities' needs. So, this is, I added this video, you guys are gonna like it, it's pretty cool. I think it just shows, I don't know how cool wildlife is. It's kind of interesting, just for fun.
Shh.
it's rough out there in the wild. What can you say? There's no easy meal. So the message I want to really get across is that attitude is everything. And the tools are only as effective as the person using them. And if you think that you can coexist with coyotes, you can. And if you think you can't, you probably can't. So, but coexistence really is possible. So good job, Kelly.
Okay, I'm Cindy Machado. I'm the Director of Animal Services with the Marin Humane Society. And it's fair to say we were one of the original coyote creative coalition members that saw, as the ranching community started doing non-lethal, coyotes, fair to say, came to your towns and neighborhoods. So our role at the Humane Society is quite simple. We're the provider for animal services throughout Marin and all the cities through a contract. We care deeply about public safety, and originally when the coyotes came into Mill Valley, that was our number one priority because we didn't know a lot about coyotes and it was scary for us as well as neighbors. So public safety was really key. We also work really hard to ensure the welfare of all animals, including wildlife. And I would say that 80% of what our field officers do every day involved responding to wildlife-related calls and educating the public. And then lastly, we coordinate resources and network with other agencies on wildlife issues. And you all are really blessed to be in Marin, where we have not only these two wonderful colleagues on either side of me, but we have a Wildlife Rehabilitation Center, Wildcare Marin, we have Marine Mammal Center. So it's rich with other entities that are doing amazing work on behalf of wildlife. So as Kelly pointed out earlier, with regard to the whole non-lethal predator program, as a result of that, in about 2002 were the first calls that we started receiving in Mill Valley and South Marin. And they were shocking when they first came in. That people were afraid. They didn't know what to do. Horse Hill in Mill Valley was the very first hangout where coyotes were first spotted. So in about September of that same year, we decided it would be a good idea to get all the agencies on the same page. We really wanted to make sure our message out to all of the community members were in unison. So you can see who we involved. We had Mill Valley Police Department, Fish and Game, the school, Animal Protection Institute, which actually Camilla Fox, our coyote hero, is now with Project Coyote, In Defense of Animals, Marin Humane Society, Marin Open Space, which is also Marin Parks, and kind of an odd group, which was U.S. Geological Society, which I'll tell you about in a moment. So that actually led to the need to do our first public forum, very similar to what we're doing tonight, only it was truly standing room only, with people outside the door. It was in Alto Bowl area of Mill Valley, Scott Valley Homeowners Association, and people were mad. They did not want to share their lives with coyotes. They were concerned about their safety. We were concerned about their safety. And it was our first attempt to really talk about coyotes. At that meeting, we actually learned that a male adult coyote had been lethally removed by Fish and Game without any of the other agencies knowing about it. And when that was announced at that meeting, there was literally a standing ovation given to Fish and Game. So we've changed quite a bit since then. We ended up starting a really specific task force with Animal Protection Institute and Marin Humane Society so that we could really develop a long-term strategy, because we knew all the science-based research we were reading, the coyotes were going to stay. It was up to us to educate the public and figure out a long-term strategy. So we really started an intensive education and outreach program. We would leave door hangers in neighborhood doors. We would go out to schools. We would focus on these neighborhood what we call hotspots, where we'd get 10 calls. There's a coyote on my back deck. There's a coyote in my driveway. Come out, and we would actually go from coyote call to coyote call. Now, the Geological Society that I mentioned earlier was really instrumental. There was a young researcher at the time that took up the idea of wanting to do a research study, and she ended up collaring three coyotes. All three coyotes were actually hanging around the GGNRA border of Mill Valley. And this happened in 2002. For our benefit, Clint the coyote was the first coyote that we learned a lot from. He was the only coyote we'd get a call about wearing a green nylon collar running down the bike path. And Clint taught us a lot of stuff from 2002 to 2007 when he finally got booted out of his territory, ended up going to San Rafael, going to Ross, going to San Anselmo, and he died on impact by being hit by a car outside of Matucci's Bar in San Anselmo. So we owe Clint a lot of goodwill because he did teach us quite a bit. So the next key moment for us was really taking a look at intentional feeding of wildlife. So in 2004, we were one of the first local communities to pass a countywide ordinance that banned the intentional feeding of wildlife. Believe it or not, that's our biggest challenge today, where people think it's fun to befriend a coyote, offer their half a sandwich during the lunch break, and that creates problems for all of us. So we really used that local ordinance as a way to target some of the problems we knew well in advance were happening. We've also had experience working with National Park Service, and are probably second biggest challenge is educating tourists that come to our parklands. So it's one thing when we have a neighborhood of residents that we can target. It's a whole other story when we have tourists that are driving through and, oh, look, there's a coyote. Let me get my camera out here, feed him my sandwich so we'll get closer. So we've done a lot with the Park Service to really continue that whole idea of, good communication. So the bottom line for us has been collaboration, dialogue, and community outreach. Okay, this is a really hard picture to see because this is purposeful, but right here is our famous coyote, Clint, on Horse Hill. And he was really savvy about blending in with the landscape. Wherever he was in those very early days, it was hard to get a picture of Clint. And the picture from this photographer, she'd set out for hours at a time trying to track him down to get his picture, and he was very stealthy. Little did we know that he would be on bike paths, he would be running along joggers and baby strollers and hikers. He knew every little side trail between here and San Rafael that one coyote could ever learn. So I'll just add to what Kelly said earlier about the Coyote Coalition and working together. But in 2005, we were recognized by the Marin IJ for getting high marks on our coyote efforts. And, quote, local ranchers and animal rights activists appear to be on the same page in this effort. That collective energy and its early success should be encouraged. I take great pride in that because I think this has really taught us that, yes, we all have to work together. Despite our differences or what our feelings are personally or professionally about wildlife or coyotes, this is the one area we do have to work together, and we've been very successful. So these are actually Marin Humane Society photos that our officers have taken, and these are the typical calls that we go out on to Marin coyotes. They're going to be in your bushes, on your back deck, sunning themselves, in your driveway, on your porch, and often on the trails that you like to hike and walk. And they are a healthy population. Occasionally, they'll look kind of scroungy from parasites. We do get pretty heavy parasite loads in the summer. We've actually had to capture quite a few coyotes that become anemic from parasite overload. They go to wild care, but this is generally what our goals are in response. We're going to educate until we educate you some more and some more and some more. You'll get really tired of hearing us, but that is our biggest goal. We want to do our best to reduce your fear, and I think that's been a challenge for all of us. I know I was a child that grew up with Peter and the Wolf and, fearing predators, and I think we have some childhood memories that predators were bad. And so many of you, it's hard to get that out of your mind to think that a predator has a place that you can not be fearful of them. So what we have found is the more we discuss what coyotes are truly about, the more awareness is built, and you all are doing a great job living with them. So we're really proud to see that. The other thing that's really important is encouraging responsible land stewardship. And this is where that whole neighborhood focus really comes into play. Because what you do can control whether or not a coyote is going to pick your home to visit, to raise their family, to eat your fruit trees or your rodent population. But equally important is what your neighbor is doing. So we've seen a lot of neighborhoods where one person's really upset about having a coyote, but his next-door neighbor is maybe putting an uncovered compost bin out, or recyclables that the coyotes can get in, attracting rodents. So we really have to encourage that we're all responsible for how we live in our neighborhoods. The pet part is my biggest call and biggest concern, and I don't blame you. I share it, but we really want to encourage you to keep your pets supervised and safe, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as I go. And we're also going to respond to any perceived public safety threats. We had one earlier today where a bicyclist was up at Indian Valley College on a fire road riding his bike, and the perceived threat was that a coyote ran after his bike. So those are things that we're going to investigate. We're going to work with local law enforcement, David's park rangers, and to get the whole story, to see if there's more intervention that we need to do. In some cases, we may poster trailheads. So it'll be really common for you to see our logos on a Coyote Be Aware poster. What we also have learned is that we have to be brave and adaptable. Just when we think we've resolved something, a coyote will outsmart all of us, and we have to change our strategies. I will tell you that Mill Valley Police Department was so thrilled about having to respond to coyote calls when they started coming into Mill Valley in 2002. And their officers would go out and patrol, and their patrol car would be, you know, tailing Clint. And they would say, you know, we're hazing them, we're trying to chase them away, they just don't go. Clint would see our animal services officer roll up in their truck, and he would take off running. So I say that only because they know who to fear and who not to fear. And so they're really adaptable and really changeable. They'll recognize vehicles. They'll recognize people. They'll recognize neighbors that won't shoot them with a garden hose and neighbors that have an extra rodent supply. So remember that. The big deal for us on the public safety side is definitely den sites, because that is the potential where we have coyotes protecting young, protecting territory. So we've been known to send our officers out to evaluate it. We'll get on the phone with Camilla and David and strategize what we should do. We'll have a neighborhood meeting. One case in Kentfield, we actually cordoned off the den with yellow caution tape just to keep neighbors from walking near it. We've had pupping events where people just want to get up close to the puppies and take pictures, and aren't they cute? Same thing. We got to get out there and educate and explain why that's not okay. We want those puppies to learn, to be trained, that humans are not a good thing. Predation on pets is the hardest thing for me, and yes, I will be the first to tell you that we have had mainly cats in this county, cats that are outside, succumb to coyotes. Coyotes do not know that cats are not on the dinner menu, and it's an easy opportunity for most of them, and unfortunately, it's a gruesome sight. The first time we were exposed to coyote killings of cats, people thought there was a serial killer loose, and so we know that they do that. And that's why we're advocating we can't prevent them from doing that. We can certainly keep our pets safe. We had a bonded pair on a school grounds in Mill Valley that took up under a slide on summer vacation. And my button on my Ensure Public Safety was dinging off the charts. We met with the principal, the school personnel, and they said, no, we'll train the kids on what to do. Kids all got an assembly educational event, parents got home, brought home letters, and by golly, those kids and the school were able to move those coyotes off site. So that's really encouraging. And I just want to make a note about when we hear the word aggressive, that's very unsettling because coyotes want you to feel like they're being aggressive to you. So whether it's following you, stalking you, keeping your eye on you, when we hear that word, it's not. I would like to change aggressive with assertive. They are going to do everything they can to fool you. And so remember that, because you might shoo them off and they leave 10 feet, they stop, they turn around, and they start following you again. So a lot of these coyotes in Marin have really learned to adapt to shouting, screaming, running after, and just know that sometimes you have to really, I won't scream in this room because it'll drown your ears piercing, but they really need some nasty people to get on them. So we'll talk about that in a little bit. And I'm convinced that Clint knew how to use the crosswalk on East Blythedale. He, without a doubt, knew when to cross the street. Somehow he made his way over to Tiburon safely by crossing 101. So they really do pick up things on how to survive. These are a couple coyotes. The one on the left was a coyote that had terrible mange. They are very susceptible to mange and parasites, and they need a little dose of ivermectin at wild care, and then they're released back into their neighborhood. And we don't know the story of the pup on the right, but a little baby pup found without mom and family. So that animal probably will end up with Kelly up at Sonoma County, because I think you have the better coyote raising program.
Yeah.
And they're raised, and then they're brought back. Okay, this is a terrible slide, but feeding wildlife equals trouble. This is an actual resident that we've cited several times in San Anselmo, not down here in Corte Madera Larkspur, thank you. But when you feed one species of animal, in this case, everybody was enjoying the buffet. Because what turkeys enjoy, deer are gonna like. What deer like, mountain lions are gonna like, because they like deer. So you're just creating a cycle of problems. So best advice is, as tempting as it is to feed mammals, please don't, because it creates a lot of problems in the end. And it is illegal. This is the tourist scenario we routinely see. And I'd love, you know, those of you that are photographers, if you're out seeing wildlife, you know, haze coyote if you're a photographer, because that's our biggest challenge. People want to get that picture. And so we've actually had photographers that have really hindered our progress on having these animals have a healthy fear of us. So it is illegal in Marin locally, as well as in the state of California with Fish and Wildlife. We will send an officer to investigate. We will be really nice. We'll knock on your door. We'll politely educate you to please not do that again. If we get a second complaint, then we might not be as nice. You may be subject to a citation if we see evidence that a wild animal is being fed. And these citations are pretty hefty. The ones that we've issued, the courts do get that's an important infraction, so you can literally be fined hundreds of dollars. So I guess the message here is, if you have a neighbor that you know is feeding wildlife, especially coyotes, we really want to hear from you and go out and talk to that person. Turn them in. You can be anonymous even. Hazing. So all hazing means is, you know, I don't want you to feel welcome in my neighborhood. We want you to be as loud and obnoxious as possible. And just when you think you're as loud as you can possibly be louder and even more obnoxious. It's really important to do that, because that's what's indirectly training these animals to fear all of us. And when one neighbor does it, but another neighbor doesn't, it defeats the purpose. So we want all of you, you know, I know it feels guilty because they're beautiful and you want to see them, but it's doing all of us and them a favor by you being willing to haze them. We have found that altering your techniques is great. So if one neighbor wants to go at it with the pots and pans, and another one wants to use the marine siren, the other one wants to use his stereo or his, you know, jet spray garden hose, think outside the box. So we just want to make sure that you're all doing at least something. These are some of our favorite tools for hazing that are relatively inexpensive. It doesn't take a lot of money to have a tool. You can use a shaker can, which is just an aluminum can that you fill up with pebbles or coins, tape the top up, and shake them. That's a great thing for kids to have in their little backpack when they're on their way to school. We've used tennis ball chuckers. Those of you that have dogs that like to play fetch, those chuckers can really throw tennis balls really far and really accurately. There's some great kids' toys out there that project things. Garden hoses with strong super soaking ability really work. Noisemakers, mobile phone sounds. Even on your mobile phone, you can download apps of obnoxious noises. And those are really creative. Whistles, and lastly, just be cautious with pepper spray or halt, because those don't always work on animals, and sometimes they can have the opposite effect. And finally, about hazing, we are not doing harm, but we're teaching. So the more this is an education for that animal, the more successful you are. So again, we're not harming, we're not hurting, we're teaching. And I had to get a slide with my cute little dog, Phil, who's the cutest little dog in the world. And he's only 7 pounds, and he would be coyote bait in a hot second. And he would be the dog that would run right up to a coyote if I allowed him to do so. So if you, those of you that have pets, you know, we definitely want your pets to stay safe. So we really recommend confinement and safe confinement that your pet can't escape from and others can't come into. If you know that you're in an area where there's coyotes, put your dog on a leash. As much as we advocate off-leash areas, if we know there are coyotes in that area, we're not keeping our pets safe if we're allowing them off-leash, because coyotes have been known to trick dogs. One of our ex-dog trainers had beautiful German Shepherds, and she tells the story of how three coyotes baited her German Shepherd down a canyon into a ravine up in Park Service off-leash area. And they do that. They will, they're dogs just like your dog, and they understand canine behavior. Know that your pet could be on the menu, and not just could, will be in many cases. And we've got some great next door alerts. I think that's why we're here today, because we had some next door concerns about coyotes, but use that to educate your neighbors. If you've seen a coyote or you're concerned about one, you can certainly call us, because we can give you up-to-date information. And always supervise small pets, especially when you're outdoors. Cat people, any cat guardians in the room tonight? Yay. Hopefully you know the dangers of outdoor kitties, but if you do have a cat and you want them to have an outdoor experience, we really urge you to consider a cat fence or a catio to keep them safe. Now, this is a product, I'm not advocating for it, but I'm advocating for the concept of this, because this is really unique. So this is called a coyote roller fence. And basically, the top part of the fence rolls. So a coyote cannot get over your fence. They can jump, and they're really good jumpers. But what people have done, especially with a wooden fence, is adapted their wooden fence so the top of it rolls, because the coyote needs to get their front legs as a foothold to get up and over. There's all kinds of adaptions. We've seen plastic piping used as rolling devices, materials that are relatively inexpensive. So if you have a smaller yard to consider fencing, this is a great option. Okay, this is the ultimate in catios. So this gives true meaning to the catwalk. This kitty starts all the way down here and walks all the way down here, and it's connected to this on the side of the house. Some of these catwalks and catios are attached to windows of homes, portholes in homes. We've seen phenomenal building and construction and portable caging to contain cats. You can Google plans. You want to make sure, however, that they have a solid, secure bottom, as well as fully enclosed top. And then feral cats. There are a number of feral cat caregivers in Marin County, and just want to remind them that we'd love it if they could be supervised feeding, where only that amount of feed being consumed for each cat is put out and consumed right then and there. That the area is kept clean of extra feed and trash, that the cats have a lifetime caretaker so that they know when a cat is missing, and to provide some kind of weatherproof shelter. In this case, there's an insert inside this, so a coyote cannot get to this cat, and the cat literally has an emergency exit if they need to get out the other side. And definitely they need permission from wherever they're being fed.
We've actually done studies that show that if you feed more than what they'll consume a day, it actually lowers the lifespan of the cats, because it draws in so much wildlife, and so it's actually worse for them.
Yep. This is our famous Larkspur coyote. I think we know that there's at least maybe, we can't count coyotes because David gets mad at me, but we always want to know how many coyotes are in this area. This coyote's up in Baltimore County Canyon, and one of our wonderful volunteers placed. She was very concerned that there was a coyote in her neighborhood. And what are you going to do about it, Cindy? You know, I don't want it going after my dog. Now she loves seeing the coyotes. She feels really good about their presence, and she actually has a camera trap that she uses, and she just captured this one last July. Okay, now David can do the lights, and we want to make sure we have enough time that you ask us any question or any issue that's on your mind, and maybe someone could help us moderate with the microphone.
I'm particularly interested in more specifics about fencing. In addition to roller fencing, is there a particular height minimum that might help protect animals?
Well, we know the Planning Commission members are all here tonight, so I have to be careful what I say on fencing, right? first and foremost, you want to make sure that you're in compliance with whatever city ordinances you have with regard to fencing.
You would be.
I mean, bottom line, with any fence, it really depends what you're trying to do, so, and what type of material it is. We have found that wire and wood fences, there's still an engagement with dogs on one side and coyotes on the other side, which is not good. Solid wood fences are great because there isn't a visual.
Right.
And height can be challenging depending on if there's things that the coyote can jump onto. So trees, they can climb trees pretty agilely. They can, wood piles that might be next to your fence, they can navigate through. So I don't know, do we want to have a consensus of generally? I mean, I don't know what your fence heights are down here, but the higher you can, the better. I mean, you're not going to fence everybody out completely.
This is in San Rafael in Peacock Gap, where we recently moved on the golf course. And people have taller fences there because it helps protect against golf balls. So there's a lot of latitude that you can work out with.
Yeah, the other more important part is there a desire for a coyote to go out of its way to get into your yard? So the scenario I often tell people is, do you have, an attractant? Is there a nice, juicy apple tree in there? Is there a compost pile with a bunch of rodents living? Is there an easy access? They are looking for the easiest place to frequent that provides safety, warmth for their den, food for their young, and hopefully a neighbor that doesn't haze them.
And so, keep them in, keep your pets in between dusk and dawn when they're, instead of letting them be in the yard unsupervised at night, especially if you're worried that your fence may not be tall enough, or that you'll eliminate a lot of problems just doing that.
I'm seeing just as many coyotes at 10, 11, 12 o'clock,
mm-hmm.
all throughout the day, so mm-hmm. that doesn't
and
seem...
And you're on a golf course, you said?
I'm on the golf course, and they're there 10 feet from golfers,
right?
Just hanging out.
Well,
so that's a really good message to get word out to the golfers. What a great place to haze. They've got golf balls in hand and clear shot. I'm not advising harm. Again, teaching. But, hey, if you're golfing today and you see a coyote on the fairground, golf course, please haze it. Bring a marine horn with you. But the other thing I wanted to say is, people have also tried using one strand of electric fencing, battery-operated electric fencing on the top of the fence or at the bottom of the fence. But again, unless you have some really magnificent attractant on the inside of your yard,
small dog,
they're going to keep going.
I didn't have to watch every second that he's outside. Every second I let the dog out, I watch him.
Perfect.
How about 7 feet?
7 feet. Okay,
there might be people here that know this
more
better than I do. But
and I don't want to take up all the time, but also the LED lighting that you were talking about, but that would be pretty obnoxious for neighbors.
Well, the fox lights would. Yeah, that's more for rural things. But what she says about keeping the attractants out is really important. If they're only come in because there's a reason to, and there's a lot of food sources on a golf course, so.
Right.
It's probably unlikely they'll be targeting pets that strongly in that situation, but it's always best to be safe rather than,
Okay, I'll pass this.
Camilla.
To add to that, the motion-activated lights that people can have in their backyards.
Right.
So motion-activated lights and also the scarecrow and motion-activated water. So
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Scarecrow's good, too.
Right. Sprinklers.
But if you have your dog in the yard at the same time, that's going to be problematic. But it will, those are good. Talk radio on it that comes on it. If you don't have your neighbor super close, Dusk Till Dawn is good on a talk radio station. Just so they think there's people out there.
But
you know?
Fence that they can't see through is the best option.
It's best, yeah, ideally, yeah.
Okay. We have one. Oh, you have the mic, so you go ahead.
Okay. This might be a silly oxymoron question, but does in urban areas do packs ever get so large that they outgrow their food source and therefore are more of a worry for domestic animals? Or do they self-control?
Who wants to jump in?
Well, their populations are monitored, self-monitoring. In other words, it only grows as large as their food sources will allow. So people think that you have to use lethal controls because, oh, my God, they're exploding. And a lot of times people see the same coyote several times, and they think they've seen a lot of different coyotes. But beyond that, they actually, predators, populations will only grow as much as their surroundings food source. So.
Okay, there was a hand over on this side in the back.
Hello. I live in Larkspur. We have a family of eight up on Elm. And I was wondering if they breed and their numbers increase, who's responsible? And we've had a lot of dead cats, small dogs. In a suburban, urban area, I saw a coyote with a dead cat in its mouth coming up the street at 11 o'clock in the morning. I have three dogs. I have a big dog and two little dogs, and I've seen the coyotes on the bike path. And I think, what do you think about having the llamas and the donkeys on our bike path? No, you talked about the ranchers and what they can do. We need more ideas because many of us are living in fear. I now have my cat, who was an indoor-outdoor, inside. And I see the signs posted everywhere, missing cat, missing cat, missing cat. So who is monitoring what is happening in our neighborhood and if things get out of control? And then there was the woman on Elm who posted on Nextdoor two coyotes were in her yard and bit her dog. And this is the day after the Chronicle article that we were cohabitating. I mean, I've lived here for 28 years, and I feel fearful about the coyotes. And I can't imagine their life, their quality of life is that good, getting hit by cars. And the question is, if they have a choice between a domestic animal, killing a domestic animal, and chasing after a wild rat, what are they going to pick?
Well, I'm going to say this, and it's always good to keep the risk in perspective. The danger to humans is almost minuscule, and even to our pets, they're more commonly killed and injured by other domestic animals rather than coyotes by a massive disproportion. And people, I think, 100 to thousands of people go to the hospital every year for dog bites. Are hospitalized for dog bites, and there's maybe a dozen instances of coyotes biting people. So, you know, when you take that risk into perspective, I mean, everything, when you think about it in life, has some sort of danger. Every one of these trees could fall on us as we're walking down the street, but so you have to manage the risk, do a risk assessment and manage the risk, and these hazing techniques really do work. And if you can go online and look at the videos of hazing if you want to get more ideas of different ways to do it. But it's very effective. I have yet to find, and I've dealt with a lot of coyotes, I have yet to find one that I can't get to move away by, you know, just hazing in the correct way. And if you're in a situation where you see a coyote and you have a small dog and you're uncomfortable, just pick it up. Pick it up and just calmly walk out of the area if you're uncomfortable.
Let me just add one more component. The Marin Humane Society tracks all sighting reports. So as much as we love Nextdoor, we don't have access to communicate via Nextdoor unless we know someone that lives in the neighborhood. So it's really helpful to us if you could call our main number, and I'll give you that number. It's 883-4621, Tuesday through Sunday from 10 to 5:30. And our staff will take a sighting report. And why those are important is it can enable us to track activity. Maybe that results in us going out to that neighborhood and leaving some door hangers to educate your neighbors. And I would really embrace it if, you know, the people on the bike trails get some of those bike riders involved in hazing. Some of those bikes make really cool sounds or little bells, but the more we can scare a coyote on a trail, the more they're not going to feel welcome on the trail.
Okay. I just wanted to clarify, I don't think she knew that the coyote attacked her dog. There was, it wasn't clear. There was an interaction, but that puncture wound could have been wood. If you read, if you continued reading a thread.
Thank you for that. And I mean, it's a good reminder. These are all canids. They're, you know, our dogs were once wolves. They get the canine body language to a T. We miss a lot of that body language, by the way, that, you know, the dogs are giving off to coyotes. So it's really important to keep dogs under our control, to not let them be in a scenario where they're going to not be supervised, and if we know that there's a coyote in our neighborhood.
And it tends to be a lot of times when someone loses a cat to a coyote, even if there's this, you know, actual sighting. I mean, outdoor cats, it's a very dangerous life. But most of them succumb to other things like being hit by cars, domestic dog attacks, a lot of other things rather than coyotes. But it's instinctive now. People think when a cat disappears, a coyote got it, but it's not.
And just, I want to clarify too, we encourage people to post missing cat signs when you're missing your cat. So number one, if you're missing any pet, cats, dogs, iguanas, box turtles, come to the Marin Humane Society to look for your pet. We're going to instruct you on how to take a lost report so that we can match up that animal. But truthfully, there are a lot of people that never come and look for their missing cat or even think to call us. So we really want to emphasize, if you're missing a pet, if you see someone missing a cat, make sure they've checked in with the Humane Society because their cat may be waiting for them up in Novato. Who else has a question?
I have a question. So I live in Baltimore Canyon, and I was walking to the car with my 5-year-old and my small dog, and there was a coyote just right there. I'm new to the area, so I don't know what to do in that circumstance. You mentioned hazing. Obviously, that makes me very nervous with a small child and a dog, and what is the right response in that situation? My back's to the animal, getting into a car. I mean, that's what it is, because you're getting into your vehicle. What do you recommend in that kind of a circumstance?
How loud can you scream?
Yeah, how loud can you scream? And not only that,
well,
just
I mean,
big.
With the child and the dog, and you would encourage engaging like
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
If the coyote's not posing a threat to you and it's far enough away, you
But how do you know if it's posing a threat? Maybe I'm not totally clear on how you know if it is or it isn't.
How far away is the coyote, are you saying?
As far as he is.
Yeah, that's
we want you to scream as loud as you can, wave your arms, you know, have a whistle on hand. Teach your child, this is what we do when we see a wild animal that isn't supposed to be this close to us.
You can use
throw something at it, you know, whatever you feel. It's a scary thing for me to tell you to do.
I mean, that
because
is scary.
My favorite story was when my mother called me on a cell phone many, many years ago. Cindy, this coyote is following my dog and I, and it won't stop. Mom, stop, turn around, scream at it, run after him. What? You want me to run after the coyote? Yes. I want you to powerfully run towards that coyote, screaming as loud as you can. And then tell me what happens. Oh, it stopped, and then I went 25 feet, started following me again. Okay, stop, do it again. So like David mentioned, they're tricksters. That coyote is trying to trick you into thinking that he's not afraid of you, that it's his territory, you know, what do you have to offer? So it's your job, it's all of our job to be, try and be brave enough to, you know, it's a 30-pound little Sheltie-sized dog with a lot of hair. So that, you know, practice before the coyote is in front of you too.
Yeah, okay.
You can use the alarm on your keychain too, if that.
Oh yeah, good idea.
Yeah.
Hello. I have a hazing idea. I'd like your opinion.
Oh, great.
But I also don't want to let loose because of the microphone, because I want to tell you my neighbor's story from last week, because we need your advice on that. So that's two-part. The hazing idea, today in the store, Costco particularly, tactical flashlights are very inexpensive now and very powerful, and if you shop carefully, they have strobe effect.
I thought about that, too. That's a really
okay,
good
idea. Okay, so it's high, low, and strobe. I recommend 300 lumens and up for power. And I've only had a chance one time myself at night to use it from quite a distance, and it was effective. But I don't know. That light is so powerful that really at 400 yards, the coyote doesn't want to look at it.
Mm-hmm.
And possibly in the daytime even.
Mm-hmm.
I know they're smart, but they're not smart enough, I think, to look away and charge you.
Right.
So I'm recommending to everybody today's modern $20 or less tactical flashlight, 300 lumens up, strobe, daytime or nighttime.
Yeah, great idea. It's going to be really effective, and it's really distracting. Even if you want it to still, you weren't scared of it, it's almost impossible to keep focusing on something moving into that strobe.
So that's the hazing idea. So this story now, if my neighbor is not here, I'll tell her story. This happened last week. This is a Madera Garden story. It's in the street between houses. 7:15 a.m., it's daylight. She has two small dogs. So, by the way, picking them up is going to be a challenge,
mm-hmm.
I think.
Yeah.
But it's 7:15 a.m., it's daylight. She is suddenly surrounded by three coyotes, and she is very scared. But she knows to scream, scream, scream. She screams, they don't go away, but two neighbor women, the house is right opposite, they're all acquainted. The two neighbor women, apparently the coyotes didn't go away, they had time to go in the house, get brooms. So the two neighbor women escorted the third neighbor woman home, which is another 70 yards up the hill, but the neighbor's petrified. So for the future. Let's
mm-hmm,
say.
Right.
So the question is thrown out to you. She screamed so loud that the neighbors in the houses heard her and came out.
Mm-hmm.
But I throw this experience out to you now. What should she do? And by the way, I told her, besides the flashlight, carry a tennis racket.
Mm-hmm.
If they come that close after your cute little dog, you may have to hit them on the head.
A walking stick. Real good
a job. Club, something. So now I throw it to you for advice for that neighbor.
I just haven't said anything in too long. So we're all here tonight because we have a group of coyotes in this area that are being overly assertive. And we have to get everybody on the same page. So when these coyotes need hazing just to make them uncomfortable around us. So that is a terrifying situation. It does need to be dealt with. But if everybody, when they see these coyotes, day or night, does whatever they can, loud noise, throwing things, all the things we've talked about, loud noise is sort of the best one just to make them uncomfortable and stomp your feet at them, stuff like that. If everybody gets on that page, this group of coyotes is just not going to want to bother being around our homes anymore. So that's every kind of hazing, but everybody has to do it.
But that carrying a weapon, if they don't back off, see, whichever way she turned, because there were three, they had her cornered. And she doesn't know what to do next.
Well, I think the walking sticks, they make those ones, are very, very light. And if they did get within close enough to her where she felt threatened, they're very light, very easy to maneuver. She could, and nothing wasn't working, she could, definitely keep them away with that. But, and I know it feels really threatening, it looks really threatening, but like we say never, but I've never been in a situation where if you were just aggressive enough, they wouldn't split. Some people aren't comfortable with that, I understand. So something like that walking stick may make her feel empowered enough to feel more comfortable.
And I would also tell her that, remember, it's really not her that they're attracting to, it's her dogs. So if she's walking with the dogs versus, you know, just outside her home, let's try and get the dogs out of the picture a little bit more. So
it's
step one.
Dog walk.
Right, so I'm just saying, is there a way we can move the dogs behind a car? Or, you know, the two women that came to her aid, can we just put the dogs away? The coyotes have to learn to fear humans first, and that's easier than the dog component, because they're going to be attracted to any dog that's in their territory. It's also this time of year, it seems like it's a little bit later this year, but the dispersing season this year, this is the time of year where those young coyotes are, you know, looking for new territory, maybe getting kicked out by mom or dad. So they aren't trained as well as the adults that know what's right and what's wrong. So it's a combination of, you know, removing the threat, empowering her to what she feels comfortable doing, and definitely having something with her when she's walking if she's not, you know, near her home. But it's a great neighborhood strategy. As David said, let's get everybody on that street ready to haze some coyotes. One's hard enough, but three can be really intimidating. And, you know, they respond to sounds. They respond to our aggressive, assertive body language. Whoever are the people in that neighborhood that group of coyotes are going to fear the most? Let's get them into the action.
Hi. Over here. So are you saying then that they will not attack back when you're doing this, if you're throwing things out, they're not like wolves or higher predators, that they will not retaliate? Are you saying that would be what I would be afraid of.
Right, and I understand that feeling, but they're more scared of you, regardless of how they're looking. They're far more scared of you than you are of them. And like I said, at the rescue, we're working hands-on with these coyotes, and you basically, once you get them caught, all you do is put a towel over their head, and you can do just about anything to them, more than I could do to domestic dogs in a veterinary hospital. They're very, very scared of humans. They're, they're putting up a show, and it looks very threatening, but they will back down.
Okay.
And the only caveat to that is if there's a den site close by, and used to haze, they may not split, you know. They're not going to, and they may approach dogs to escort them out of their territory and away from den sites. So that if they're protecting a den site, they're not going to go for your throat or run out, but they'll be more less likely to give way quite so quickly.
Hi, I live in Santa Venetia on top of a hill. We have a lot of coyotes. I have two big German shepherds, and they don't seem afraid of the German shepherds. In fact, they seem annoyed that the German shepherds are in their territory. I always have them on leash, and I've always carried things. My family says I look like Rambo. I leave with sticks and stones, and, you know, and I shout as loud as I can. And I think sometimes, because they're canids, I think they can hear fear. So when you scream, if you're screaming with a loud, you know, a high voice, I wonder if that makes them feel like, you know, you're afraid. What I did try was this pet corrector. I don't know if people know of it. Mm-hmm. It has like a hissing sound. Mm-hmm. So I had a coyote coming towards me pretty fast, and my dog seemed even scared. And they're 75-pound German shepherds. So we all, you know, I was shouting, I was throwing things, but nothing was working. And then I tried the pet corrector. I did it twice in the air, and just the sound of it, because it was such a different sort of snake.
That's the key. Yeah,
I really like what you're saying about shake it up, try some different things, mm-hmm. because I think if we're screaming in a loud voice, in a high voice, that may not be helpful.
Coyotes are especially...
You can get them online. They're just
our little... compressed air. You could use compressed air, too. Yeah. Coyotes are very scared of anything novel in their environment or anything novel they hear. Very, very intimidated by that. So that's why switching it up works really well to just something that they're not used to hearing. That's the most effective things, is stuff that's really unusual, like that strobe. That would freak them out.
Yeah, that's great.
And this might seem like a dumb one, but you kind of have to use their language. One thing that I learned working with coyotes is that's like I'm showing my teeth. You don't smile at your coyotes when you're working with coyotes. You keep your mouth closed. So if you all of a sudden show your teeth, literally, that's the way, you know, that's going to get a reaction out of them. You can be scary.
Yeah, so if you have that energy, like, oh, you know, they're not going to take you seriously. Like, oh, I'm too nervous. You just got to fake it till you make it. Pretend it's an acting job. And just stand up there and be very secure and get your message out, like you're yelling at your kid or your husband or whatever. That kind of energy. Or maybe that's just me.
And practice. Practice before you see the coyote. I mean, the ones that do this the best are kids. When we have the opportunity to do assemblies at school, we invite children to practice their hazing, and they are magnificent. They are powerful. They are assertive. They are aggressive. Any coyote in their right mind would run quickly away from some of these children. So follow our kids' lead and ask your kids, what's your best fun toy that makes a noise and is obnoxious that, you know, mommy can use tonight, today? Because there's some really good toys that are fit the bill, too.
Any comment with regard to the Chicago population and similarities here?
Camilla, do you want to answer that? Camilla's here. She probably has more information than any of us. I'll let her comment.
So what we know is in Chicago, you've mentioned the study there, so they're now in the 16th year of a large urban coyote ecology study, which is really fascinating because we're learning lots of interesting things about urban coyotes that we actually really don't know. So everything around diet to how they navigate the landscape, how many animals actually come into conflicts, which has been really fascinating because they collared over 400, looked at how many come into conflicts with people, with pets. It's a very, very low percentage. I think it was of 481 that were collared, 7 came into conflict. So it's relatively few, and most of those conflicts were actually associated with feeding, intentional or unintentional feeding, or 4 of those 7 actually had mange. So they were compromised, and that made them a little bit more susceptible to aberrant behavior and wanting atypical foods. So it's still underway. It's really fascinating, and we're learning more and more about these coyotes.
That study also showed a very, very low percentage of their diet was domestic pets, very low percentage.
That's a really good point, and actually I want to reiterate that because there was another similar study done in Thousand Oaks area looking at coyote diets, and what they found was that even when they had access to human or anthropogenic foods, they were really going for the natural foods. So the insects, Jerusalem crickets, big fat juicy Jerusalem crickets, fruit, and that's something to really think about, that if you're trying to deter coyotes in your yard, you really want to look at what kinds of things might be attracting them, and fruit can be a major one. And fruit can be a significant part of their diet depending on the time of year.
And what kind of things are in your yard that could attract rodents? Because rodents are what's going to draw them in too. So if you have a lot of brush, heavy, you know, dense cover, sometimes thinning that out to keep the rodents back will keep the coyotes less attracted.
And another one with that is bird seed. So if you're feeding birds and the bird seed is actually getting on the ground, that can attract rodents, which then attract coyotes. So,
we just want to thank you. You gave us all a whole bunch to think about, and I came in here with the perception, and I've worked for the, you know, in this town and community for 22 years, and I learned a lot today, and it's just food for thought of different scenarios and the hazing techniques. I think that's really what I got out of this. I don't know how many of you have, but what to do in certain situations. If you're walking your dog, you want to get the dogs out of sight, maybe go behind a car, just the little techniques like that. Maybe have a tennis ball to throw at them, you know, and if you're by your car with your kids and you're getting into the car, hit your alarm. I mean, perfect things that I never thought about, but these are things that as a community we can start thinking about. I just want you all to know, again, this is recorded, so to share it with as many people as possible. Also, we're going to, in Corte Madera and Larkspur and the Central Marin Police Authority site, as well as their 3 organizations, we'll put all that information and literature onto our websites. And so just to continue the conversation, and as things come up, we would be happy as the town and city to facilitate conversations in our communities if we get a scary situation, like you talked about, sir, to go out and talk to those people and to really educate all of us. And so I hope you found this to be helpful. It's the start. It's not the complete solution, but it does give us food for thought and a process to move forward. So I hope this was beneficial. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And have a good night.
And if If you have other questions, something comes to mind or something you just didn't feel comfortable talking about here, take a picture of the screen and give any of us a call. I've almost always had at least an email after each one of these forums. So that's my job.